Hachette Audio presents The Shit No One Tells You About Divorce, a guide to breaking up, falling apart, and putting yourself back together. Written by Don Dais. Read by Lynn Norris. We don't talk about grief as a part of change enough. It does people a disservice, because when they hit grief, they think they've done something wrong. Change always includes a series of small deaths, and if we don't understand that grief is going to be a part of change, and that loss is going to be a part of change, I don't think we can successfully evolve. Brené Brown. So where do we find grace and light? If you mean right now, the answer is nowhere. Grace always does bat last, and the light always overcomes the darkness, always, historically. But not necessarily later the same day, or tomorrow after lunch. Anne Lamott. When you're going through a hard time, just eat ice cream in a dark place. Get a bunch of different flavors. My daughter's 10-year-old friend. Do you know why divorces are so expensive? Because they are worth it. Willie Nelson. Introduction. Welcome to your mean time. In the beginning of my divorce, when everything had gone ass over tea kettle and life felt very, very raw, my divorced friends would repeatedly assure me that everything would be okay. They were a few years ahead of me on their divorce timelines, and they knew from experience that things would eventually calm down. They'd tell me, "Just give it time. Everything will be fine. You guys will be fine. Just give it time." I'd respond with, "Yeah, that's great, but what the hell am I supposed to do in the meantime?" The meantime of divorce is brutal. It's the time between the end of your marriage and the beginning of feeling normal in the new version of your life. The meantime is the time required for that new version of life to feel worn in instead of ill-fittingly new. The good news is, my friends were right. Time did help, and everything did end up settling down into a comfortable new normal. The bad news is, there are no shortcuts through the meantime. Trust me on that one, because I repeatedly tried, and failed, to speed up my meantime. I tried to MacGyver the broken parts back together. I tried just blaming everything on my ex. I tried putting my fingers in my ears, closing my eyes, and yelling, "Everything is fine!" over and over again. You'll be shocked to learn that none of those strategies were successful. I've written this book for those of you still working through your meantime, because I know how confusing and isolating and infuriating that time can be. I know how aggressively odd it is to keep moving through all of life's responsibilities when your head and your heart and your entire friggin' world feel like a snow globe that has been shaken up by a 3-year-old on a sugar high. I wanted to write a book to remind you that you are not crazy. You are not irrevocably damaged. You are just a human navigating a ridiculously complicated period of your life. Also, as I mentioned previously, you have some time to kill. So why not listen to a profanity-laced book about divorce while you wait for your snow globe to pull its shit together? The audiobook you're listening to is a pretty detailed account of my meantime. It is messy and raw, introspective and evolved, and everything in between. At times, my words are enlightened, self-centered, shattered, crazy, appalling, and kind. And that is just a sampling of the myriad of emotions that are constantly swirling around during the meantime. What an exciting life experience! I tried to be as honest as possible in writing this book, while still being conscious of the fact that I'm writing in permanent ink about quite a few other people whose lives were exploded along with mine. It was a delicate dance that I'm not sure I always pulled off, but I hope the end result is balanced and that our journey can provide a little camaraderie to others traveling a similar path. In an effort to add to that camaraderie, I chatted with a lot of other divorcees over the past couple of years. I refer to these men and women as my divorce squad throughout the book, and I've included their stories and opinions to expand upon mine. All their names have been changed, and I feel genuinely grateful that they all trusted me with their truth and vulnerability. I would talk for hours with different members of my divorce squad, each of their stories varying wildly from each other and from my own. But no matter the details, there seemed to be a through line in all of our narratives, a universality to what it really feels like to have everything fall the fuck apart. There was an ease to our conversations, because letting go of all pretense is pretty freeing when you've been pretending to hold it together for so long. Instead of the standard, "Yeah, everything is totally fine," these conversations started with, "It was not fine, and let me tell you all about it." From there, we were off and running. These conversations inspired one of my favorite parts of this book. During each divorce squad chat, I would share that I was trying to get into the right headspace for writing, because I didn't think it would be appropriate to write an entire book with every chapter titled, "Fuck you, you fucking fuck." All the divorced people would laugh at this joke, and then every single one would say, "But I'd like to read that book." It got me thinking. Healing from divorce is a long process, and it's not necessarily a linear one. Some days are better than others, and sometimes your namaste efforts are no match for your, "Oh, for fuck's sake," reality. Often, just when you think you're making headway, something will throw you off track. Your ex will do something particularly ridiculous, or you'll come across a video on your phone of your life pre-split, or you'll be engulfed by the loneliness of your new reality. On those days, you might not be feeling particularly mature, or evolved, or healed. On those days, you may just really want to scream, "Fuck you, you fucking fuck!" And I'm in full support of such screaming. So much so that I decided to include regular rage journaling interludes throughout this book. The "Fuck you, you fucking fuck" journal prompts are scattered among the chapters as a place for you to let go of all pretense and lean into the things that are not fine. They are a safe place for your profanity to roam. This book focuses heavily on divorce when kids are involved. Our girl and boy were 9 and 7 years old when we split, because that was the particular shit show I had to navigate. But no matter what the circumstance of your split or where you are in your meantime, I hope this book can help you as you make your way to the other side. Pull up a seat and let's commiserate for a little while. We'll rage and laugh and introspect and cry. And cuss. We're going to cuss a lot. There can be no healing without a fair amount of cussing. It's just science. You're welcome. Chapter 1. The Long Goodbye. Marriages break apart tiny pieces at a time. My ex, Elizabeth, used to wash her hands several times a day, wipe them on a paper towel, then throw the paper towel on the counter instead of throwing it away. Every day. Multiple paper towels all over my counter that I was left to clean up. This started to absolutely infuriate me. These paper towels caused a seething, blind rage. One time I conducted an experiment where, instead of throwing the paper towels away, I piled them up on the counter, creating a multimedia art installation of sorts. It could have been titled, "Grown-ass woman can't throw away her own garbage." Elizabeth shrugged off my art piece and even added to it herself to demonstrate that I shouldn't be trying to teach her lessons like she was a child. And that's the kind of moment you just know things are going smashingly well in a relationship. In a long partnership, it's expected that things will ebb and flow with good times and bad. But when the flow of bad times starts to overpower the good times, it can inspire a bit of introspection. We take a hard look at what we've built and really consider whether it has any value left at all. When the answer is no, we often don't want to admit that we've invested so much into something that should be thrown in the trash pile. So we hang on to it. We polish it up with some couples therapy and date nights. Maybe take a weekend getaway to duct tape the broken parts. We do this over and over again. Sometimes throughout years and years, ignoring the cracks, pretending the glimmers of good are enough, until finally, something too big to ignore lands the finishing blow. In chats with my divorce squad, I found that a good deal of divorces come about after some sort of big, rattling event. Cheating is a common one, mental illness, egregious financial deceit. Often there's something significant that triggers the final time of death. But even in those cases, I tend to believe the relationship was most likely slowly breaking down well before the inciting incident. When I asked my divorce squad about the moment they knew their marriages were over, most of them homed in on moments that occurred well before they actually got divorced. Because that's what relationships are, really, a series of moments, each of them moving us closer together or further apart. In my case, the series of moments included a series of paper towels. The paper towels were indicative of other issues, obviously. With two small kids and a partner, I felt like my life had become consumed by caring for other people, and I was deeply resentful that Elizabeth seemed, in my mind, unwilling to do basic tasks to carry her weight. Basic tasks like throwing away a motherfucking paper towel. Instead of addressing my paper towel rage or trying to get to the root of why a piece of garbage sent me over the edge, I simply pushed my feelings down and piled them on top of everything else I was barely holding together. Moment after moment, I pushed more and more down. A huge part of my navigating to the other side of my divorce was the work I did to unpack the years I spent with my ex and all the things besides the paper towels that I had pushed down for so long. I had to look at that time with honest eyes, own my part in it, and wrap my mind around the whys of it all. Why had I given up on us? Why did I stay for so long in such a bad relationship? Why did I become such an ugly version of myself for the person I'd chosen to do life with? There's a popular metaphor about boiling.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.